everyone. So this talk is about user testing. So thank you so much for coming. Okay, so I'm Jen. I'm a UI designer. And usually my job is laying out screens and working on workflows and things of that nature. But something I've become very interested in is user testing and user research. I design board games as a hobby, and a big part of that is user testing and play testing. So that's a way I originally got into it. But at my job, I've done a few micro tests and a user interview, so I've started to learn more about the user research world. Okay, so we're going to be specifically talking about micro tests today, which are short, simple user tests. But there's some other options if you are hoping to gather user feedback on a product you're working on. So some examples of that are you could write a survey, you can do user interviews, or you could do a more formal test. So just before we dive into it, I'm going to give you some pointers about how, if you wanted to run a test yourself, how you might be able to throw one together. But it's always a good idea, if you know anyone who has a background in this, to ask them for help. I personally have one of my coworkers is really knowledgeable about this, and she helped me understand the data that I got, because if you're not really a statistician, it can be difficult to, you might come to an incorrect conclusion. So it's always good to ask an expert. Okay, so what is a user test? A user test is a way of testing how well your product is usable by people who you hope to use it, your users. And the three terms that people like to use are usable, learnable, and satisfactory. So that's kind of what you're testing for. So what is a micro test? A micro test is a simplified user test. You have fewer participants, and the main goal that you would be looking for is early problem identification. So the idea is that you would do this early on in the development process and find out if there's any large problems that you should address before you start getting really deep into development. So you can use a micro test to test any sort of product, hardware, software, even a workflow or an experience. So you could use this for all sorts of things, not just software. So, okay, I think there's a lot of designers in here, but I think it's really important to emphasize, why is it important to test software with users? Because who are we developing software for? People! We're not developing software for robots. We need to put it in front of people to see how people react, because you never know how people are gonna react, because people are weird. Okay, so test early. That's a big part of the software development process in the FOSS community, which is really great, but I feel that the user tests and putting things in front of users is often left until it's released. And so user testing is something that you can we can have the same ideology for. So, and the big reason for this is the whole sunk cost fallacy, because people are a lot less likely to go back and try to make changes if they've already put in 1,000 hours into building it. If you build this beautiful feature and it was really complicated, and then it turns out that it's just super unusable, it was really difficult to make and the engineering behind it is beautiful and amazing, but no one wants to use your feature, you haven't really built anything very good, have you? So it's better to do this early before you put in the effort. You're much more likely to get a better product and be willing to be agile and make changes. Okay, so for this talk, we're using the example of Fedora Land. So there is an amusement park, and they have an app, and the app helps users locate rides within the park. So this whole talk is going to pretend that we have this app, and we're going to write a user test for it together. So the point of this app is that it helps the patrons find different rides in the park. It shows the location of the rides on the map, and it shows the user's location. And we can imagine that they'll be walking around this park, and we're going to be testing this Android app with them, let's say. Okay, so selecting testers, who's going to represent the user? So, who are the final users of the product? What is their level of domain knowledge? Do they know a lot of information, or do they have background on the scenario that you're going to be putting them in? Have they used other apps that are similar? And have they used products like yours before? So what you do is, depending on the type of test you're gonna be running, you can create some criteria based on your goal. Okay, so for this example, for Fedora Land, the minimal requirement is that a tester is unfamiliar with the park. At the very least, you don't want to be testing with someone who's very knowledgeable about where the rides are, because then you won't be able to tell if they're just finding the rides based on their own personal knowledge or if they're using your app. So that would be the minimal requirement. A better requirement would be, can we find some testers who might actually visit the park and might use the app? Some people with smartphones. So you might try to hone in on that. Then, once you've found a group of people who fit that criteria, it's a good idea to try to find some diversity within that group. So for example, you might want to find people from different demographics. Maybe a parent with their small kids, or a teenager, someone who is in a wheelchair and finding their way around the park. So you're giving, you're testing your app with different groups. You might find different problems. Okay, and also, in addition to that, you don't always have to test the entire population who might use your product. You can do targeted user testing, which would be choosing a subsection of the population. So let's say, for Fedora Land, I only wanted to test if this helps people with parents with kids, and I wanted to see if how that population was able to interact with the app. I decided I didn't care about if teenagers could interact with the app. And so I could run a test just focusing on that population. So in my personal experience, techies can make really bad testers, and I think it's something that's really not people don't realize until they've experienced it, but this is something that I've run into in a few of my tests. It's very funny. A lot of times people get very caught up in the technology that you're testing, and rather than act as a user, they'll ask you a lot of questions about how it was built and what the hardware is and stuff that the average user likely won't have to ask. That said, the caveat to that is if you're designing something for a technical person, they should be the person you're testing it with. But a funny example of this was in the show Silicon Valley. I don't know if anyone watches that, but one of the main characters sent his product out to all of his friends, and everyone said, wow, this is the most amazing product ever. It's going to do great. And then they released it, and everyone hated it. A ton of people downloaded it, but everyone stopped using it immediately. Turns out the reason is he sent his product to a bunch of people who had the background knowledge that he did. He basically tested his product with his demographic, so it was totally a useless test. And it fails, and it's all funny. But the point is, if you're just testing your software with people who are exactly like you, you're not actually learning anything. So it's a good idea to put it in front of the average user. So how many testers should you have? For a micro test, for a small problem identification test, 5 users can be enough. 10 is great. Obviously, the more people you you test with, the more likely you are to have correct results. That said, since microtests are more about problem identification, you don't need 100 people to tell you you have a problem. Once you see it the first time, you have an idea you have the problem. Once you see it a third time, you're pretty sure, okay, this feature needs to be reworked. Once 3 people get caught on it, you don't need 100 people to tell you. So, interacting with testers. When you're working with testers, it's really important that you're trying to run the tests as if you are not there. Unfortunately, it's usually not possible to do that, but the perfect world, you wouldn't even be there. So you don't want to influence the tests. And a big part of that is staying neutral, and that is with neutral language. I don't know how many people have experience with neutral language. I'm going to throw out an example for you guys, and I want to see audience participation, if you could pick out which is the neutral phrasing of this question. So first, phrasing A, do you like this presentation? Phrasing B, do you find this presentation boring? Phrasing C, how do you feel about this presentation? Okay, which is the one that did not lead the audience? Yeah, 3, okay. So yes, you wanna be phrasing things in a way that doesn't lead your tester. So if you keep saying things like, how do you like this feature? The word like implies a positive attribute to the feature. If you say, oh, did you get confused? You're implying that they got confused and it was difficult. So it's better to try to phrase things as neutrally as possible. Also, it's just a good idea not to emphasize that you were involved in creating the product. If you, usually testers aren't even people who are involved in the software development process. Usually they are their third parties. But in this case, you're making a product, you want to test it. It's totally fine to do that. But you just don't want to keep emphasizing like, oh, I have to go back and develop, change this feature now. Because people will be less comfortable giving you negative feedback, and you want negative feedback. Okay, so designing a user test. Let's start with this example that we were talking about, and we'll work backwards. So once you have a user test, you'll have a packet of this thing you've written, and this is an example of a page from one. Okay, so we're gonna do the first task of the Fedora Lands app test. Okay, so the first task, select a roller coaster. So I give everything in green is stuff that you would read out loud to the testers, and everything else is just notes that the user would be, the tester would be referencing. So select a roller coaster is the task that we're doing, the overall task. On the setup, let's say we would restart the app and make sure it opens on the landing page of the app. So then the task instructions, which you would read out loud to the user. You are visiting Fedora Land and are excited to ride the roller coasters. The first coaster you want to ride is Hyper Kitty. Show me how you would view this coaster on the map. And then for yourself, you have these different ways that they could complete that action. So let's say within this app, there is two different methods, two different workflows they could go down to complete that task. They can do it in two steps here, or they can open the hamburger menu and do it in a few other steps. What you'll be doing is recording what they do, each of their tasks, each of their taps on the screen. And then after, it's usually a good idea to ask them how easy or difficult. We'll go into the rest of it later. But basically, the first task is a good idea to give the user a background, kind of give them a setting, tell them who they are and what the scenario is, and keep it simple for the first one. So this one was literally just, I'm gonna select something on a map. It's not trying to find anything yet. It's not trying to dive deeper. It's just, you know, getting them comfortable and teaching them what the flow of the test will be like. Okay, so with user testing, it's really important to be specific. You're not just throwing the app at a user and watching them use it. That's something you can do, but it's not necessarily what we're trying to do here. We're trying to be a little more scientific about it. Think of this as an experiment, and you want it to be repeatable. Also, you don't want to influence. It's really important to think about influencing the test accidentally by variability. So you want to, get rid of as much variability as possible. Okay, so every time you make a test, you're going to be thinking of an overall goal for that micro test. So what is the main thing that you're trying to learn by putting your app in front of users? So an example, for the example we're doing, I was thinking about what the pivotal feature of the app was, and was there any features that I thought might be confusing with the app, and those and with that knowledge, I wrote out a goal. So the goal for this one is, can a user with no knowledge of Fedora Land find a ride by using the map app? So it's a very specific thing I'm trying to learn. I'm just trying to see if the app is useful for them in navigating. I'm not asking about other things. That said, we're going to be breaking, every time you write a goal, you have to break it into objectives. So objectives are the steps that it takes to build to the larger goal. So navigating the park might be, is one thing that is built together by a lot of complicated steps. So it's one kind of more complicated goal that's built by doing more simple steps, excuse me. So, okay, they're basically the basis of the tasks you're going to walk through, and it's the workflow of how you would achieve that overall goal. So breaking down the goal we talked about, the Fedora Land objectives would be, can a user select a specific ride and find it using a map? Can the user switch between different rides on the map? So those are two things that are going to be important for a user to be able to achieve the goal of the test. So we want to make sure they can do those smaller tasks. Okay, so So secondary questions. You know, these are not the main point of the test, but while we have the app in the hands of users, these are things we want to look for and just check on and see how if those features are resonating with users, some questions that are just in the back of my head that I want to answer early on that might affect future development. So some of the secondary questions for this Fedora Land app are, what are the users' preferred map orientation? Do they know how to access details about the ride? How long does it take them to find a ride? Do they use the Zoom feature? So these are things that I might not write a whole scenario around, but I'll be paying attention to when they're performing the scenario and kind of marking down if they do those things. So we've been talking about scenarios. Those are the questions, the things you will read aloud to the user, and the tasks that they're going to walk you through. So, and these are written based on your objectives. So the smaller parts of your goal, the portions that the workflow that builds to your goal. So, you know, you keep it simple at first and you work up to more complicated tasks. Okay, so my objectives here were, can the user select a specific ride and find it using the map? Can the user switch between different rides on the map? And then the scenario I wrote based on those objectives were, you hear that HyperKitty has a really long line, but that the Tux Flume is empty. You want to head to Tux Flume. Show me how you would view this new ride on the map. So now I'm learning if they're able to switch between different rides on the map. And then the next scenario might be, please take me to Tux Flume. And so then you might follow them around the park and see if they're able to. So ease of use is a temperature check that it's a really good idea to do after every scenario. Every time the user performs a task and they've given you any feedback, a way to start the conversation is say, how easy or difficult was it for you to perform this task? And then you have a rating scale from easy to difficult, and they rate it, and then you can ask them to talk more about why they rated it. And so you just kind of can take notes and also, over time, you'll see how many people rated the same tasks differently. You'll kind of get an average of the ease of use. It's not technically statistically accurate, but it gives you an idea. Yes?
So how exactly are we noting their responses or their reactions?
So I think I'll show it later, but the idea is that you've written this whole document of the text, things that you'll read aloud, things that the questions you're going to ask, and then also notes for yourself of how the app needs to be set up before each scenario. And one way of doing it is printing out a packet, and that'll be your note-taking packet. And each time you have a new user, you'll print out a new packet, and you're able to, you'll be marking directly on that. So I'll show you, I'll give you some specifics for that later, but for example, if I got up to the usability scale for one of the tasks, I would just circle. Like, let's say they said somewhat easy, I would circle it and make a note right underneath. Okay, so in addition to the general temperature check, there might also be some open-ended questions that you want to ask your user. So some of them might be probing feedback questions specific to the tasks they just completed, but it's always a good idea, even if you don't do them, do have specific questions, it's always a good idea to end with the question, is there anything else you would like to share about the task? They might say nothing, but they might give you a little more information and might start further conversation. Remember, these should be phrased neutrally, like we went over before. So, did it occur to you that you could zoom in and out of the map? That's a neutrally phrased question. How helpful was the directional arrow when finding the ride? That is one that is leading because you're using the word helpful. A better way, if you wanted to neutralize that question, you might say how helpful or unhelpful was the directional arrow. If you're going to use a positive, it's always good to throw in the negative, but if you can just remove any positive or negative words from your questions, that's always better. You know, these slip in here. I did a test with a similar scenario and I accidentally asked how helpful it happens. Okay, so I'm gonna go over this kind of quickly, just to let you know there's a thing called SUS. You can do more research on it later. It's a 10-item questionnaire that you ask at the end of a usability test. It gives you a number at the end. It's not a percentage, but it'll give you a number that you can base on other usability tests to give yourself an idea. Are you above average usability? Are you below average usability? The questions are phrased, and it's also kind of similar to the ease of use scale, where they're answering these questions on a scale of strongly disagree to strongly agree. It's questions like, I would like to use this system frequently, I found the system unnecessarily complex, things like that. And so they'll rate each of those, and you can put it into a calculator, and it'll give you a number back. I think you're looking for above 70, above 68 is considered above average. It's useful, but you don't, just because you get above 78 or 62 or whatever, it doesn't mean that your product is usable necessarily. It means it's above average by these metrics, but there can still be problems with it. So it's one thing to use amongst many other things. Okay, so running the test. So we talked about this a little already, but you'll be writing a script that you follow with each user, which will eliminate any variability. You want to make sure that you're saying the same words over and over again. It also reduces the chance that if a user behaves differently from one test to another, that it was because you influenced them. It's probably just because the users are different people. So the good thing, first thing to do for your script is have an introduction. It sets expectations for what the test will be like if they've never done a test before. It, you know, kind of sets the tone and the speaking style and makes them comfortable and gives yourself an opportunity to answer any questions they might have. So I'm not going to read a whole one, but thank you for giving us some of your time today. To improve our products, we like to obtain feedback from end users during development. That is the purpose of today's activity, and then you would keep going and say, today we're testing Fedora Land app. This app is supposed to help you navigate the park. We're looking to see your thoughts and expectations around this app. So you would write out a thing describing what the goal of today was. So the test packet, that includes your script, the setup for each task, the steps to complete the task, and whether they've passed or failed, either of those. The ease of use scale and space to answer any open-ended questions. So you'll be taking a lot of notes during your tests. You're going to be encouraging the tester to think out loud, because sometimes people might just, you know, be walking through the task and you can watch them, but it's more helpful if they're saying what if they're surprised or if they get caught on something, kind of probe them and see what's bothering them or what they don't understand. And then you can take notes on what they're saying. So this is another example of what a page from a packet might look like, and the red is examples of notes that I might have written. So this instruction, we went over this one already, it was a task where you had them switch from the tux flume to the tux flume. So let's say these are the two different methods that they could have used to succeed at the app. Let's say they went down this path, so they select the correct ride. I circle yes, they did that. They did this, I circle yes. Was there any assists? I say zero. I'm gonna go into assists in a moment. And then I ask them the usability scale, they rated it 2, I circled 2. When I asked them if there was anything else, they said they wanted a back button, so I took a note of that. So anything that they were kind of saying throughout the task, I might have noted on this page next to the different steps. Okay, so assists are kind of confusing. I think they can be difficult, but the idea is that you're not testing the user. You always want to let the user know that I'm not testing you, I'm testing the app. But you're testing to see if they succeed at different tasks. You kind of put that on a scale of pass and fail. So if you are in the middle of a task and the user is taking a really long time to complete it, and you can tell that they've gone down an incorrect path, and that there's no way that they're going to come back and do the task correctly, you might want to assist them and put them back on track. But if you do that, you need to make a note of it, because they wouldn't have been able to complete that task by themselves. So also, if they give up or are unable to continue, yes?
Does it automatically set the task to fail?
Yes. So you would add a, you might want to make a note if they eventually are able to do it, but you would give them a fail for that, because the idea is to see if they're able to do it on their own if you weren't there. So if you have to help them, they failed it. And that's for you to say later, okay, this feature might have been confusing, so I might have to go back and do it. And you want to make a note of the number and the type of assists. So let's say they were looking at the map, but they got confused and they had selected the wrong ride and they started walking towards the incorrect ride. They had failed the task. Is it worth it for me to let them walk across the park and fail before I tell them? No, it's probably okay for me to stop and assist them and put them back on track, but I just need to note that they would have failed. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's see.
Okay. Something I realized I missed with the neutral talk before we go to this is another thing to worry about. We talked about neutral language. Neutral body language is another thing to think about when you're testing users. You don't want to accidentally point at the screen and kind of show them hints of where they're supposed to tap if you're doing a test that involves walking, like this task would, because it's a navigating app. You don't want to walk in front of them and kind of hint which direction they should be moving in. That can be very difficult. You have to just kind of stand behind them and try to be a neutral party. Also, you can't show any emotion based on their ability to complete or not complete a task. You don't want them to feel like they're failing you. You know, you don't want that. You're supposed to be a robot. You're not even supposed to be there. So you don't want to make them feel good or bad about their ability to complete the task. Because really, you're testing the software's ability to help them do it. So, okay, so evaluating the test. So now we've walked through all of these things, and let's say I've had 5 testers. I've recorded all of their ease of use and all of their feedback and their passes and fails. So now I just have a ton of data. What am I going to do with it? So this probably could be a whole talk about making spreadsheets for data, but I'm not going to go into detail, but the idea, a way of doing it would be to set up a spreadsheet and for each column, write the task and the steps that it would take to complete the task and just record if they passed or failed each task. And then, you know, see the average, see if certain tasks end up having more fails and others have more passes. And you can start to pinpoint and get an idea of which tasks have a lot of fails. Let's say one task, 50% of people failed or needed to have help to complete the task. You know that you need to rethink that feature. So you want to look for trends, like I was just talking about, and also you want to see if there's any repeated user comments. So maybe everyone was able to complete a task, but 3 people mentioned that they were confused at first by a certain icon. You might want to, you know, you take a note of it. Technically, they were able to do it, but we want to look into that feature. Also, you might notice that some tasks have a really high ease of use, and people totally were able, 100% of your participants were able to complete that task, and they all rated it highly. You know you probably shouldn't touch that. It's probably good. That's also an important thing to know, because sometimes when you're developing things, you don't really know what's successful or not successful. You don't want to go in and put your finger somewhere where it's actually perfect. You should leave it. Also, you can check if you're how your subscore did. So, based on that trend, you can take note if you have successful features and pain points that you need to rethink. So, you'll have all this data, and now it's time to take your favorite brainstorming method and come with all the developers and designers and come up with a solution. Thank you. That is the talk. Yeah. So I wanted to take, any questions, and also if you had any products that you wanted to maybe do a micro test for and you want to talk about how you would go about doing that, I'd be happy to talk through.
I have a question.
Yes?
How's a micro test different from a regular test? Because if you do is it just question after each task, how many tasks would that be?
So I think the difference between a micro test and a larger test is the scope. So it's you're still going through a lot of the steps you would do for a normal test. You're still being very thorough, but you're doing it for a smaller subset of features. Maybe you're only concentrating on one main feature. Also, you're doing it earlier in the process with the goal of problem identification, as opposed to later in the process with the goal of general usability. Also, you would probably have fewer participants. So I think a larger test, usually people look for 20 participants or more. In this case, maybe you only have 5.
Right. Do you do that online or offline?
Oh, what do you mean?
Well, I mean, sometimes you have to do testing online using some recording app or something.
Mm-hmm.
And also, do you record people in microtests? Do you do the video part of it, or is it just something?
So you can. I think that would depend on your personal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I was hoping to get new people who might not be super familiar with testing to give it a try, and if all of this background, like recording and, you know, having all this large setup, you don't need it. It could be helpful for looking back at the test, but it's not a requirement. Also, for the online thing, I think you absolutely could do it online with a shared screen. Might be a little more difficult, but you could probably get the same information.
Do you find you order your micro tests in a certain way to sort of try to emulate the way the user would use the feature in the first place? Like, obviously, if you want to work up to a more dip, like, do you find you order them in specific ways, or is it just
Yeah, I think a big part of testing is easing the user into your app. They might have they've likely never used it before. So, and also, forgetting easing them into using the app, you're also easing them into the testing process. So if they've never been a part of the test before, you want to give them an idea of, okay, first I will give you a scenario, you will complete the task, I will ask you ease of use, and then, so they kind of get the steps of each task, and it's better to do that. I mean, almost the first one is almost a throwaway. It's usually a task that doesn't even matter a whole lot. I mean, it's probably something so easy that you would assume that a user would be able to complete it, but it's just a way of easing them in. And then, yeah, I do like to build up, because sometimes you're looking to see into the specifics if they're able to complete the smaller tasks that build up to that larger goal. So I usually want to stop them between each of that smaller task. So even if the task was clicking the hamburger menu, selecting something else, and then bringing it up on the screen, I want to stop them and make sure that works for them, and if there's any issues in that before we go on to the larger test, which is following them around the park to see if they can find the roller coaster. Any other questions? Does anyone have any products that they were thinking of testing? Okay. Well, thank you. That went more quickly than I thought. If anyone ever wants to contact me if they need help with testing and they want to run a test, my information's up here. I also have some cards if you're interested. And I would love to help you if you have any further questions. Thanks.